So as other, many others here, I indeed thank the organizers for inviting me. It's not me personally, just as a recognition that data analysis is part of systems analysis, which I always maintained. So the contents, I will be trying to be rather brief. First, I will be telling of the summarization data recovery model, including singular value decomposition and more recent items like topic allocations. Then I will interpret k-means very well known clustering method in these terms and will show how it can be much improved with this. And then I will turn to ranking. And this is a big issue now for me. I am really interested that a project could be launched somewhere. And I was thinking that the maybe the systems analysis should be a very good place to go. So let me start with the problem of data summarization. You can see here a table of my students in the Birkbeck University in London, six of them, and the marks over software engineering, object-oriented programming, and computational intelligence. So what I want, not me, it's Francis Galton, the founder of the entire area back in 19th century. He was he wanted to prove that the talent is inherited. But to prove it, he needed first to measure it. And how we can measure? Well, the people typically take the average. So the guy in the end gets 75, the average, so his talent, according to this data, is greater than the talent of the first one, 65. But Carl Pearson, the founding father of statistics, who was a great philosopher and also a collaborator to Francis Galton, he was a little bit better than this. He said, okay, so let we have an unknown score of talent for a student. But we need some other data, like loading of the subject. And if you take a product of this, then this should give us the mark that the chap has received. So this basically equation gives you a model of if you can measure the talent, that you need to go back a feedback to the data, to the original data itself. And this is quite a good equation. Well, you cannot satisfy it because the marks are a huge area and the talent score and the loading score are just vectors. So you, what you want, according to Pearson, is to find the vector of talent, a vector of loadings, by minimizing the recovered data, this data, the difference between this data and the original data. This was his idea, and what I do is just extend this to many other problems. So this is the model by, unfortunately, in 1900, when he invented this, matrix theory was not known. But currently, if you write it in a kind of more mathematical way, as it is here, and the solution is called the principal component, then it's quite easy to prove that the solution would be the first singular triplet of the matrix of marks. If we denote it by x, what is here, mark, is it is x and if we want to minimize the deviations in, as usually with the least squares criterion, then the solution is just this triplet satisfying this equation. And what is more, because of this model, we have this Pythagorean decomposition. This is the most important part, in fact, in my thinking of this. You can measure the impact, the contribution of this specific solution, unlike when you do just the average value to compute. And this, of course, was easily generalized to, in fact, a real situation. They hired Charles Spearman for doing this research, and Charles Spearman found that it was not just one talent, but there were several talents in every person, so that you have a matrix that you want to, matrix of these factor scores and the matrix of loadings that you must find to minimize. And if you want them to be of rank P, or just the number of columns in them would be P, then these are the first P singular value triplets. And this principal component analysis is becoming more and more popular. In 5 years ago, people in data mining published a book, 10 Most Popular Algorithms in Data Mining. And from the data summarization view, it was only one of 10, the k-means clustering. And this principal component never was mentioned. Probably in this year, they would include it into there. Now, it has an interesting, interesting extensions to what they call latent semantic analysis. It's just the same model for tackling for the information retrieval. And also in France, they call it analyse de correspondance by analyzing co-occurrence data, again with some twist, which I have no time to explain. So that the only maybe a kind of interesting new development, which is not quite new, it's already 10 years ago this topic allocation appeared, that the data is not the original data, it's probability. So when you analyze text, a set of documents, and you have a set of words, keywords, say, then the data is a probability of occurring a word in a text. And the model first proposed by Blay in 2003, that there are some topics hidden that should be discovered, and the again, this probability distribution is just the product of these two, of the matrices expressing these probabilities. And this has become very popular in text analysis, and has a lot of modifications and so forth. So what I am doing, I extend the same model for clustering. I just remind very briefly what is cluster k-means. It's just you have a set of points, and you throw a set of centers, and then you do two steps. You assign the entities to the centers according to the distance squared Euclidean, and then you compute in what you have got the centers, new centers. Then you test if the new centers coincide with the previous ones, you stop. If they don't, you repeat the same. What should I do here? I can do nothing as far as I understand. So this is a very simple method, and it has an important base. So it's according to Google, it's the most popular, but I found out that basically Google lies about this. So it's one of the most popular methods, and I have no time to describe why it is so good. What is mathematical about it is that there is a criterion, is the sum of the squared Euclidean distances to the centers of the clusters that is minimized alternatingly by this method. And what I found specifically, because basically this method, this criterion can be put exactly in the same terms as the principal component analysis criterion, with the only difference that the Z, the scoring vectors, are here compulsory 0, 1 to denote cluster membership rather than the talent scoring. And this now when you have this, you again have the Pythagorean decomposition, in which this criterion is parked, unexplained, and what is explained is this piece. And now I'm analyzing this piece because it's obvious that to minimize the k-means criterion, I can maximize this. And now, when looking at the meaning of this criterion, I can see it's quite easy. What you want to do, it's a squared Euclidean distance to the center. This is the number of elements. So what you want to do, and the center is the grand mean, this vector of means of the entire sample. What you want to do is to find the most anomalous, most deviated from the grand mean, and most numerous because of this. So this is an entirely new meaning to the criterion. And this can give hints how you can do it. So I've developed a method that does it by building clusters one by one. Yeah, if k is unknown, and it is a typical case that the number of clusters you don't know, so you start from the first cluster, the most distant one, then you remove it, and you continue with the what remains. So the this method has been published by me several times. And I had a PhD student in London, this Mark Chang from Taiwan. We published, he did a huge experiment. I think only a Chinese person could survive such an extensive experimentation. We generated data with round clusters and with elongated clusters, and the spread between clusters and within clusters was different and so forth. And we found out that this method of one by one is superior to the most popular methods published by others. I call it intelligent k-means. Just the method appeared exactly when the iPad appeared, and I like the idea that lowercase could be added, because my English at the time was not as good as it is now. So I was following suit. Now this I'm going to skip maybe, just one mention that the k-means method is defenseless against a situation in which there are noise features, the irrelevant features. Typically, even with doing systems analysis when selecting features, some features can be irrelevant. And it appears there is a simple method that you can control the weights of the features. And with this, I had another PhD student, a Brazilian, Renato Amorim, and we got a record number of errors the minimum that of all the literature, both supervised and unsupervised, on this data set. And one more. Recently, with another my student in Portugal, in Lisbon, we applied the same method. It's about finding anomalous clusters one by one to a temperature map. In Portugal, there is this big issue of upwelling when the winds from Canada blow in the summer. The water somehow turns upside down, which creates a very fertile place for fish. And fish is a very big in Portuguese economy. So what appears that we do exactly the same. Oh, unfortunately, my criterion disappeared. That's a little bit. Or maybe not. Let me check. Yeah. So this is the criterion which differs from anything. This problem basically comes as a segmentation problem. I never did anything on segmentation, but we just applied it starting from the coldest temperature from one pixel and then collecting according to this least squares criterion. And it recovers upwellings quite well. And unlike the other methods, it has no parameters to specify, except for this criterion. I would like to move on about ranking, because ranking now, to me, is a much bigger issue. It's about research assessment. In the United States, every 5 to 6 years, we have a research assessment exercise, which now is called somewhat different. I'll take a look at it. And every department is evaluated. And it takes the most distinguished scientists in the country about 4 months of their time to look at the department achievements and to assess them. So the government wants to shift to metrics. It's not only government. The public also, now we have university leagues. So my thinking is that the metric tide is probably for long now. So we should do something about it as systems analysis scientists, that we should propose some criteria for assessment of researchers. Because of the globalization, the research has become, it's not now only among scientists. Banks do research. The programmers do research. You know, the websites, actually everybody is doing research right now in informatics. So it's a matter, to me, is becoming a very important matter. And recently, with this, a very, distinguished scientist went out a year ago with what they call DORA initiative, San Francisco Declaration on Research Assessment, because of the ubiquitous use of citation. When I left the department in London, I don't know what happens now, but every good university in the United States hired according to the Google citation, this Hirsch index and other things. So they declared that the impact, this citation, is not the only one, that every product should be taken into account. And so in this specific talk, I have several, basically three results to report. So the method of aggregation of criteria, automatic, then I think I'm the first one who proposed direct measurements of the quality of research. not via some, dubious, not straightforward measurements, but just exactly this result, what is its contribution according to domain taxonomy. And I will be trying to be real brief on this. So the method for combination of criteria, I think I will skip it because I have no time. It's published in English in a series of reports of my university in Moscow. So if you put down Mirkin and my co-author, another PhD student, Orlov, unfortunately he defected. In Russia, very talented students go to sciences and they defect when they need to do a little bit of effort because it's, this is what I discovered by now. So just only to show that the strata and clusters are different. So the strata are according to, let me move on. So this is, again, the least squares in finding this. So we have a method that finds it, and we tested it a little bit variously. Now, how the quality of research results should be measured, it must be a well-established taxonomy of the field, the domain taxonomy, and according to the rank in this taxonomy. This is how I propose to measure. So we took up the data analysis taxonomy from ACM, Association for Computing Machinery Classification. They maintain it already for more than 20 years, and the last release was 3 years ago, in 2012. So this part, then this I show what relates to what they call data mining, clustering, and others of this. And we picked up 30 leading scientists for whom we could find data of citation and of a few other features that I will show just in a second. So this is how the ranks of say two of them are Panos Pardalos, the a known specialist in global optimization, asked me specifically to include him, although he, in my view, was not a data analysis specialist. And myself, I keep the others anonymous, but they are, all, of course, all available, all these data, again, not names. So what we've got with our method of automatically determining, the Hirsch index has got zero weight, which I was very happy with, because it received a very very critical acclaim and refutation, I would say, in Russia at least. But still, the government wants to use it, and the universities are starting using it as well. Then the merit, we've got this data of the number of PhD, number of conference chaired, and the number of editing editorships. So this and the aggregate citation and merit have some correlation between them that I consider is to up to the popularity, and there is So then I started considering what are the products of scientists. So I think there are five products, five types of products, like say in teaching, these are the features, and also the societal interactions that were pointed out in this specific area. I'm coming to conclusion, I skip the data summarization issue. I don't want to skip it. So I reflect what I'm doing in my textbook, that had a very favorable review in ACM. And I put it into clustering. So this type of thinking I applied not only to k-means, but every type of clustering, the clustering of similarity data, consensus clustering, fuzzy clustering. Pretty much of things. So what I want to, now, they asked me specifically about the big data. So the k-means is very suitable very suitable for big data because it can run parallel. And the MapReduce technology is a huge invention that I would need about an hour to explain, which so I'm going to skip as well for doing this big data. Unfortunately, it's more like an exercise. It is not used by the real things. So the last, not least. So I was thinking that a project in developing metrics for assessment of research impact should be run maybe from this institution, I don't know. And it should involve then the defining a taxonomy of systems analysis and making use or making sense of these 75 definitions mentioned several times. And so there are some stages that involve real kind of organizational effort that I have no time to present. But the potential outcome is not only the cleaning of your own stables, which is a substance, but also methods could be developed that nobody have heard of them. Thank you very much.